Now let us start with the structure of forebrain. As said earlier, the brain is basically divided into three parts, forebrain, midbrain and hindbrain. So let us first of all understand the structure of forebrain. Forebrain is considered as the largest part of the brain. It is formed of mainly three regions. First is olfactory lobes. Second, cerebral hemisphere or cerebrum. And third, diencephalon. So let us first of all understand the structure of olfactory lobes. Olfactory lobes. This figure depicts the vertical section of the brain. As it can be seen from the figure, these olfactory bulbs, that is olfactory lobes, occur in pairs which are small and thin transparent in nature. That is, olfactory lobes occurs in small pair that are thin and transparent in nature. These lobes remain hidden due to the presence of cerebral hemisphere in front. Thus, these lobes are covered by cerebral hemisphere. That is the second part of the forebrain. These olfactory lobes can be seen only from the ventral view of human brain. This is all about the olfactory lobes. And now let us begin with the second region of the forebrain, that is cerebral hemisphere. As said earlier, cerebral hemisphere is also known as cerebrum. Cerebral hemisphere covers the olfactory lobe. As it can be seen from the figure, this major portion or this larger portion forms the cerebrum. Cerebrum is considered as the largest part of the forebrain and therefore the brain. Moreover, this cerebral hemisphere is divided by a line like longitudinal fissure, that is, this line is mentioned as the fissure, which separate different lobes. Thus, the entire cerebrum is divided into various lobes. By longitudinal fissure. as it can be seen from this figure. There are deep folding like structure known as gyri, and the depression between them is known as sulci. Therefore, structures like gyri and sulci form the most important part of the cerebrum, which helps in the division of these lobes. Thus, highly folded structure that is present within the cerebrum is called gyri. And the deep depression deep and wide depression between them that is gyri forms sulci. The outer surface of this cerebrum is known as cerebral cortex. And therefore the function of cerebral cortex would be the protection of the cerebrum. Within cerebrum, due to the presence of longitudinal fissures, there occurs myelinated nerve fibers within the cerebrum. And these myelinated nerve fiber that is present within the cerebrum is known as corpus callosum. Now, these sulci, that is the wide depression, form or divide the cerebrum into mainly four lobes. That is, it is very obvious the sulci formation occurs mainly because of longitudinal fissures, and these fissures divide the entire cerebrum into mainly four lobes. This figure depicts the four lobes of the brain or the cerebrum. As it can be seen from the figure, these cerebral hemispheres divide the cerebrum into four lobes, that is the anterior frontal lobe, the middle parietal lobe, the lateral temporal lobe and the posterior occipital lobe. Each have their definite and specific function. So let us first of all begin with the first, that is anterior frontal lobe. The anterior frontal lobe mainly controls voluntary movements. That is the voluntary action. However, within this frontal lobe, there are a few areas which perform the other function, like the premotor area of the frontal lobe performs involuntary and autonomic nervous system action. that is the action that are performed by involuntary nervous system and autonomic nervous system. Then the second area, that is associated area, performs different functions like memory, reasoning, learning and creative ability. Of the organism. That is, it enhances such functions of the organism. Then comes the second layer, that is middle parietal lobe. This lobe is mainly associated with the functions of touch, temperature, pain, and the sensitivity or senses like cold. The third lobe, that is posterior occipital lobe, this lobe mainly performs the sensory function. For example, the auditory area, which is present within the occipital lobe, performs the function of hearing. Then the second area, that is visual area, present within this lobe, performs the function of seeing or sight. Thus this lobe controls the main two sensory organs and its action. Then comes the fourth and the last lobe, that is lateral temporal lobe. This lobe is associated with the functions of other senses like sound, smell, increases the emotional ability, and thinking. This was all about the lobe that is present within the cerebral hemisphere. This figure depicts the vertical section of the human brain. As said earlier, corpus callosum are the large myelinated nerve fibers that are associated with the cerebral hemisphere. Now this cerebral hemisphere encloses a cavity here, which is highlighted in blue color, is called lateral ventricle. Thus, cerebral hemisphere or cerebrum encloses a cavity called lateral ventricle. As it can be seen from the figure, this lateral ventricle is closed in front, but at the behind, it opens into the third ventricle. Thus, this ventricle is closed in front and opens behind into third ventricle. This third ventricle is a region of diencephalon, that is the third part of the forebrain. And this lateral ventricle that opens into the third ventricle occurs through a region known as foramen of Monroe. Thus, foramen of Monroe is considered as an aperture that connects the lateral ventricle to third ventricle. This was all about the second region, that is cerebral hemisphere. And now comes the third region of the forebrain, that is diencephalon. As said, diencephalon is a structure that forms the central part of the forebrain, which is surrounded by cerebral hemisphere. In such a manner that it encloses the cavity of the third ventricle. Now the diencephalon is divided into various regions on the basis of this ventricle position. First, epithalamus. Epithalamus is a region that forms the roof of this cavity. That is the roof of the cavity of third ventricle. Then comes second region, that is thalamus. Thalamus forms the right and left side of this cavity. Then comes the third region, that is hypothalamus. The third region, that is hypothalamus, forms the floor of this cavity. Now this epithalamus is made up of nervous tissue and blood vessels. which forms the anterior choroid plexus. This is the vertical section of human brain. As it can be seen from the figure, this anterior choroid plexus is formed or made up of the blood vessels of the epithalamus region. As it can be seen that just behind this epithalamus there occurs a stalk-like region or a pineal body, which is an endocrine gland. Therefore, just behind the anterior choroid plexus occurs the pineal body, which is connected by a stalk-like region called pineal stalk. Now this pineal body, as said, is an endocrine gland and therefore it secretes hormone melatonin. This we have already studied earlier. Now another region, that is hypothalamus, is visible only in the ventral view of human brain. That is, can be seen only in ventral view of the human brain. This structure or this region of diencephalon is small, which is only 4 grams in weight. Another endocrine gland, that is pituitary gland, is attached to this hypothalamus. This pituitary gland is very important endocrine gland. By a stalk-like region known as infundibulum. Thus, pituitary gland and hypothalamus are connected by stalk-like region called infundibulum. Then, as said earlier, that the diencephalon, it encloses a cavity termed as third ventricle, which communicates anteriorly with the lateral ventricle of cerebrum, that is the cerebral hemisphere, with a cavity known as foramen of Mondor. Moreover, posteriorly also, it is attached with another ventricle, called fourth ventricle. Thus, it is attached posteriorly to the fourth ventricle by a structure known as iter, which is in the form of narrow passage. That is, its structure resembles to that of the narrow passage.